That's how Jesus will greet you. Shalom. That's in the name of Jesus, the Lord of the universe, I greet you. Shalom. That means peace among you, peace to you, and peace for you. Before we start, let's just bow before our God and pray and acknowledge his presence and acknowledge that we're here for his sake. Father God, thank you, and we praise you, and we worship you. Thank you for this place. Thank you for this country. Thank you that we can freely get together and worship you. As we congregate, may the Lord, you humble the speaker, you humble the listener, and all together we can hear your voice, because we want to see you more clearly. We want to see your love more clearly. We want to see your grace more clearly. We want to see your kingdom more clearly. In your son's holy name we ask, amen. I title it's near. Something is near. Something big is near. When we say things are near, usually either they are closer in distance or they are time is coming, right? So something near. So now, when we talk about time, time is really elusive. Time is really, in a sense, a theory. It doesn't really exist. When you say tomorrow, does tomorrow ever come? Tomorrow never comes, because always today. Think about it. It's always today. Tomorrow never comes. So when you think about time, it's really interesting. Now, these days, we actually call these days called timeless time. Because today, I can email 10,000 people like that. I can email to you, and I can email people 3,000 miles away like that, right? So in the old day, it may take a lot of time to do that. But these days, like that. So just think about this time. So when we talk about something near, now the reason time exists is because there's space, okay? The reason time exists because there's space. We are a spatial, three-dimensional person living in this space. So when things move from here to here, that so-called time passed. So if there's no space, there is really no time. You got that? All right. Now, Jesus came on to this earth, and this is what he said. And time has been fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the gospel. Now, when he said that the kingdom is near, what does that mean? Does it mean time, or does it mean distance? It's not coming out. It's supposed to come out. This is a poll. Well, it doesn't work for me. It's supposed to connect to the internet and you can poll it. Well, it does not work. That's okay. Let me just poll among you. Who think this, when Jesus said his time is near, when the kingdom is near, the word near means time? Raise your hand. Okay. Who think is distance? Some say distance. Can it be both? Can it be? Okay. Unfortunately, I can't pull this. I don't know why it doesn't work. I was trying to see how it works. It doesn't work. Anyway, in real time, you can poll, and I will tell the percentage of who believes in A or B. So actually, this word near in New Testament came up 41 times, and look along is 18 times. But in 18 times, 15 of them means distance. Only three times means actual time. And most of when we talk about the kingdom is near is in Luke's. So, some version says the kingdom of God is at hand. At hand. That means this close, at hand. So, my title is See is Near. Can you see the kingdom is this near? That is my purpose today. Now, when Jesus said this, the kingdom is near, do you think they can understand? Can anybody understand? I think it's pretty hard. Even today, it's pretty hard for us to completely comprehend. So he tried to explain. Oh, he said the kingdom of God is like farmer sowing the seed, and some sprout, some does not. He said this kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. It's so small, but eventually grow. Mustard seed is as small as powder. He says kingdom of God is like a net. When you pull, you throw the net, you pull it back, and you figure out some, there's some good fish, there's some bad fish. So kingdom of God is some good, there's some bad. So is also talk about kingdom of God if someone has found a precious pearl, something very valuable. In those days, these are the most valuable jewelry. There's no diamond then. So something like that would be very, very valuable, worth maybe millions of dollars. So it also talk about like a piece of land. It talk about like a yeast, which something grows slowly. Talk about something like wheat. So it's confusing. What is the kingdom of God? And he was asked by the Pharisees, and his response was, well, kingdom of God is not what you can look for here or look for there. Kingdom of God is within you. So what is the kingdom of God, and where is the kingdom of God? Is there is something tangible, but there is also something invisible. So we need to think about and go through the questioning yourself and ourselves, what exactly kingdom of God. Now, of course, this is confusing. So there's a man named Nicodemus, came to see Jesus. This is in John 3:3, and asked Jesus, how can one see the kingdom of God? And Jesus' response was in the bottom there, that I truly, truly, I tell you, you have to be born again in order to see the kingdom of God. Actually, Jesus was saying you have to be born from above, because those words are the same. Above and again was the same word, but Jesus did not correct him, did not correct Nicodemus. He just kept on saying that you have to be born of the water and the spirit. Otherwise, you cannot see or enter the kingdom of God. Now, the water here is not water baptism. Water here is a physical birth. You have a physical life and your spiritual life. So, Jesus is talking about a different kind of a life form, a different kind of sphere, different kind of domain, a different kind of a life. So what is life? If I ask you, simple question, what is life? You live life every day. You know you have life, right? You eat, you sleep, you move around, and but if I ask you what is life, I bet if we poll this on Google, it will be at least 20,000 essays out there, and people may not totally agree with each other. So let me give you a little exercise. This thing has life? Yes, no? No, okay, I'm glad. This thing has life? Okay, a little different. This thing has life? This thing has life? This thing has life? That's my son's dog. I learned a lot from this dog. When she meets me, she's really happy. And I really learned a lot from this dog. So what is the distinctiveness, the character, the characteristic of what I just showed you, a life with and no life, and a level of life? Is simply this, an ability to relay. The ability to relay. I'm sure some of you have deceased family or friends. What happened? You totally cut off. there's no way you can communicate. So when we cannot communicate, we don't have life. When we cannot communicate with God, God says we're dead. We're actually dead in his vocabulary, in his dictionary. We do not have life. Until you're born again, you cannot have life with me. Therefore, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, what is the gospel when Jesus says that believe, repent and believe the gospel? He said that let the captive free and let the blind see, and the coming of the kingdom of God is here. Now, we definitely did not see Jesus free the prisoner in account. We saw a lot of healing of the blind and lots of talking of the kingdom of God. Clearly, that captive free was not about physical captive. We need all to pay attention to all those blind healing, because in there is a profound mystery in there about how we see. These are some of the scripture reference of recording how Jesus healed, and in a couple of references there. And some of the references just a man wants to be healed. Jesus said, "You're healed." He didn't touch him. He didn't do anything. Your face has healed you. And there are other places. The man wants to be healed. And then Jesus healed him and asked him, "What do you see?" He said, "Well, I saw men like trees." And then Jesus healed him again. He said, "Oh, I see clearly now." Now, in those incidents, it's very clear this man probably was not born blind. He most likely was able to see before. That's why he can say it is like men. So when Jesus touched him and has to do it twice, what does it mean? Is that a therapeutic failure? Just like do it again? Of course not. Jesus is trying to tell us, sometimes when we can see, we thought we can see, after a while, maybe we can't see that clear anymore. We might have to come over again to be healed. Now, there was another man was outside Jericho, and he called for Jesus to heal him. He says, "Son of David, mercy, mercy on me." And Jesus came over, asked him to come over. They brought him over. Now, I'm a doctor. I'm a surgeon, and I go to see a patient, and he's bleeding. What would I do? Stop the bleeding right away, right? Or I would ask him anything first? No. Of course. Lord of universe, all the healer of the all time, he came over and saw a blind man. What did he do? He said, "What do you want me to do for you?" He actually asked a question. "What do you want me to do for you?" If you were a disciple next to him, would you be saying, "Hey, Rabbi, are you crazy? I mean, can you see? I mean, what he needs is obvious?" But Jesus asked, "What can I do for you?" You know, this man is blind, but I'm sure he heard the story. Jesus fed 4,000, fed 5,000. Those days, the blind for sure is a beggar. Beggar, most importantly, need food. So he came face with this Lord of the universe, and he said, "What do you want me to do?" Do you think he might want to ask, "Oh, I want a food for the rest of my life. I don't," or something else? Do you think a blind man really know what seeing means? You have never seen anything in your life. You walk like that in your life. Nothing. And you tell him there's something better than what you are now. It's called seeing. Do you think he has any ability to understand? I think it's hard. I think it's hard. He may not be able to understand. Now, Jesus is standing here today to ask you the same thing. What can I do for you? What can I do for you? He's actually seriously asking. Would you be saying the same thing? "I want to see. I want to see the kingdom." Or you want to say, "I want a college degree without study." Think about that. So the other healing, all right, is interesting about the way it happened. The way it happened, Jesus actually put some dirt and put his spit and put on this guy's eyes and then tell him to go wash off. And then eventually, after that, he was able to see. Now, the implication and speculation is that most likely this guy may have a hollow, basically hollow. He needs something formed. And we know we are formed by the dust and by the word of God. And so that was maybe what had happened. But what more important is that he had to go to the pool of Siloam. It's something he had to do. He can't just sit there. It's something he had to do. So on these couple of healing, every healing has a very deep and profound message behind it. Now, after the healing of the man born blind, the Pharisee does not believe. So this is what Jesus responded to these Pharisees that who does not believe. He said, Son of Man come to judge, so that the blind will see and those who can see will become blind. Those that you can see become blind? What does that mean? It's clearly telling those people think they can see, but actually they don't see. And we ought to ask ourselves how much we're blind. You know, when you're blind, you're blind, you're blind, you're blind. You just don't know you're blind. Just like the fish doesn't know he's wet until people tell you you are wet or you're blind. But when people tell you you're blind, will you believe you're blind? Think about that. So let's look at what Jesus said again. So maybe we can see the kingdom a little bit clearer. Jesus said, it's like a mustard seed, the kingdom. And it will eventually grow that big from this tiny little thing. So the message is that it takes time. And so be patient. So some of you, especially young, if you are not able to see the kingdom that clearly, just be patient. Jesus also said the kingdom of God is like someone who at night will throw the weeds. So we and the wheat together. What does that mean? Good and bad together. That's the interference that we have every day. There's an enemy in this kingdom. The kingdom of God is like a field. And so when the guy saw this field, he would sell everything and buy this. It's a choice. It's a choice. The kingdom of God is like a pearl. And the guy would sell everything. So where your money is depends on where you can see your kingdom of God. Jesus didn't say, where your heart is, your money will be. He said, where your money's at, where your heart is. Where your money is where your heart is. So look at where your money is, then you know where your heart is. So these are a couple of summary in terms of what the statement we just saw, what Jesus said of the kingdom of God. So it takes effort. It takes time. It takes patience. It takes battle. It's a constant choice. And it is not easy, it is hard. I tell you, at the very end, all human, throughout history, throughout mankind, throughout wherever you are, after your basic physical and physiological needs are satisfied, there are only three things. We all ask the same three things. Number one, we want to be worth something. We wanted to know we value something. We need to be affirmed. We need to be loved. Unfortunately, we're not doing a good job among each other. Parents and children are not doing a good job among each other. Men and wife are not doing a good job among each other. The second thing is that in the midst of all this chaos, complex, constant change world, we need something that it doesn't move, doesn't change. And that is only in the kingdom of God. And thirdly, in the certainty, facing the certainty of death and disease, we need hope. And that's three things we can only find in the kingdom of God. This is basically what Paul says, love, faith, hope. So how do you live? How do we live? This is called a GPS of life. It's not a global position. This is God-pointed system, and I have three things for you. It's know your geography, is where your location. Know your position, then you have a strategy. Now, where you located matters. If you don't know where you located, you don't know where you're going. So you are in the kingdom of God. This is distant. And this is broken by different domain and different sphere. When those of you profess Christ, those of you have the Spirit of God inside you, those of you are born again, you are in the kingdom of God. That's your location. Now you're in the kingdom of God, you are a child of God. Say that, I am a child of God. Amen. And beyond that, you are a prince and princess. Beyond that, you're royalty. That will get you wake up every day. Understand that you are royalty. Not only that, you're ambassador. You're ambassador for the kingdom of God to the kingdom of the world. Now, when Jesus on earth, he says, the kingdom of God is at hand, because he's right there. He's the king. Of course, the kingdom of God is at hand. He's not here now, but you are here. The Spirit of God is inside you. The Spirit of Christ is inside you. Wherever you are, the kingdom of God is there. You are the ambassador. But more than that, we have to fight. We're a soldier. There's battle going on. And sometimes we like have to be like a spy. Some of the jobs, some of the battles are covert, cannot be fought. So you are like CIA, you are MI6, something like that. So what's your strategy? This is the strategy. Seek his kingdom and his righteousness first. And the promise of God is that everything, all things will be given unto you. It's all things. Remember the word, all things will be given unto you. But first, kingdom of God. Now, that means everything for everybody in every stage of your life. When you're this young, you're that young, that age, what does that mean in your daily activity? It's a little different. For me, at that time, when I was in Ohio, when I was in training, and when I read this, for me was that I want to go to church every Sunday. And then when I finished my training, my prayer was that I want a place I can go to work every Sunday, or a schedule that allowed me to serve in the church, allowed me to serve, and God honored that. But there's battle. It's not always smooth. I actually got forced out and forced to resign from my job because I was not covert. I was too overt at preaching the words and talking. So they don't like that. So they pushed me out of my job. But God is faithful. From Cleveland, I got moved to Ventura, Ohio. But from there, God gave me a different view of life. From there, I went to medical missions. And these are the places I've been, in China four times, India, West Africa twice, Jordan twice, and Haiti, Paraguay. You honor him, he honor you. He provides everything. This was a picture when I was in Haiti, when I was attending to this young girl's ankle. There was a voice came to me, and it says, ask me, why did God allow this to happen, earthquake? And without hesitation, I responded that he is reminding us to seek his unshakable kingdom. That was my answer. And it was a television crew. I don't know which television. I hope it broadcasts to many places. This is in Jordan. This is my favorite picture. This is up on a stage. This is an Asian man touching a Muslim woman in burqa under three crosses. That is the power of God's reconciliation spirit. God bless us with a marriage, 42 years. We just celebrate in... It's Valentine's Day was our 42 years anniversary. But all this time is not all... We got a lot of fun, but two flawed people together. You got a lot of fussing, a lot of fighting, a lot of failure. But when your fusion is the Holy Spirit, you know you have the same purpose. You know you're fused together, not just for your own pleasure. You're fused together for the battle of the kingdom. And quickly, when you fight, you reconcile, because you know if you keep on fighting, there's no way you can fight the real battle. So this is when I was 15, she was 14. That's how long it was. No, I'm just kidding. So seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness first, and all this shall be given unto you. You're making all kinds of decisions every day, all choices, from young to old, everybody. We all make decisions. And this is my testimony. When you follow the commander's strategy, everything turned out all right. My life is not full of just smooth sails, a lot of physical problem, financial setback, career setback, all that. But God is faithful. Now, as I said, it's hard. It is hard. How hard? Jesus said, it's hard as a camel go through that needle. How small that needle hole is? You can't even see. So is it possible? This camel go through there? The kingdom, you enter the kingdom of God is like a camel going through a needle. Is it possible? No. It's not possible physically. But it said right away, but in God, all things is possible. It needs to be transformed. It needs to be transformed in order for that to happen. So how does it work? Jesus says, blessed is the poor in spirit, for there is the kingdom of heaven. So poor in spirit, okay. Are you poor in spirit? You think you, maybe? Are you poor in spirit? You see you're blind? You even keep on saying, truly, truly, I tell you, you have to become like a child. Humble like a child. Humble like a child. Is child humble? Yeah? What's humility? Is courteous humility? Is soft-spoken humility? Is considering other all the time humility? Yes, yes. Soft-spoken humility? Yeah, yeah. Are those the character of children? Children soft-spoken? No. Are they thinking about others? No. They're mostly selfish. Are they boasting? Yes. So what is it that Jesus said when we be like humility like a child? It takes me a long time to figure this one out. It's dependent on your parents. There's nothing you can do. You gotta depend on your parents. Otherwise, you don't have food, no place to sleep, no clothes, can't go anywhere. You're playing in the middle of something, your father says, let's go home. You don't like it, but you gotta go home. So you gotta obey. Even reluctantly, you obey. And the same thing Jesus is telling us. You want to enter the kingdom of God? Be like a child. Be dependent on me. And be obedient to my words. As simple as that. So let's look at the final parable of the sowers and see why some grow, some don't grow. So don't you understand this parable? How then will you understand any? The farmer sows the word. Some people are like seed along the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes away the word that was sown in them. Others, like seed sown on rocky places, hear the word and at once receive it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution come because of the word, they quickly fall away. Still others, like seed sown among thorns near the word. But the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desire for other things come in and choke the word, make it unfruitful. Others, like seed sown in good soil, hear the word, accept it, and produce a crop, some 30, some 60, some 100 times what was sown. So three things: worries, wealth, and wrongful desire. These are three things block us from the kingdom of God grow inside for us. So do you worry? Do you worry about your score? Do you worry about your school? Do you worry about your boyfriend? Your boyfriend, nobody watch your Facebook? Do you worry about your health? Do you worry about your finance? Yes, yes, yes. Man, Jesus, don't worry. You know, worry is truly a sign that we do not depend on God, that we depend on ourselves. That's why you worry. The deceitfulness of wealth, money, really grab people. Beware. They don't really solve problems. One of the famous quotes is people ask Rockefeller, how much money is enough? One of the richest men on earth responds, just a little more. Never enough. And it takes you away and takes you away and you cannot see the kingdom of God. Many people have one foot in the kingdom of God, most other foot in the kingdom of the world. They cannot move. They cannot move. And wrongful desire. Desire is fine, but a wrong desire, we gotta check it. You know, playing video game is good, but you gotta play like 3 hours or 3 days at a time. That's not good. There are too many other things I don't have to mention. You know what I'm talking about. Everybody's desire is different. Everybody's tempted differently. When I go into Target, there's nothing bothers me. There's nothing I like. when I go into a car shop, ooh, my eyes open. We're all tempt differently. But you gotta check that desire. Now, how do you check this thing? Three things is my constant theme: worship, word, work. Worship, work, work. Constant thing. That's how we continue. So now, what happened here? Paul has a little spin and tell us what kingdom of God is not. He said kingdom of God is not eating, drinking, but peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Now, I have walked you this far for almost 40 minutes now. And the whole purpose is for you to see clear or see more. Now, when you read this, and God raised up with Christ, raised us, means you, in Christ, and seated you with him in the heavenly realm in Christ Jesus. Does that mean far away? No. So when you say, make your kingdom come, your will be done, when you pray that, do you think that someday the kingdom will come? Or that right now kingdom will come? So it's near. It's right here. It's at hand. It depends on can you see it. Depends on can you see it. If you absolutely don't understand what I'm talking about today, then you're totally blind. You somewhat understand. It's okay. Little by little, it will open up. I understand some of you are going to be baptized, and hope that that little step will further open your eyes even further. And that is the reason we're able to be in his kingdom. That is the reason. Jesus said, if I don't go, the Spirit cannot come. So he has to die. The Spirit can come. When the Spirit comes, then we'll be able to have the Spirit inside us. So now, when you pray, thy kingdom come, remember that, it's not up there. It's right here. It's today, right near you. It's at hand. So that's right. Let's go through this together. This is the Lord's Prayer. And let's read the Lord's Prayer together. Hope that you read in a different light. Our Father, Father, we just thank you that you have given us the access to your kingdom. May the Lord open all our eyes, open our blindness in our heart, cleanse the sins inside us so that blindness will be open and your kingdom, your grace, your love will be much more clear. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for these young people for their patiently sitting there listening to your word. In your son's holy gracious name we ask, amen.
Yes, God, help us to remember what we heard today about your kingdom being here and being inside of us, and how we should desire your kingdom above all else every day. And I pray that your kingdom will grow more and more inside all of our hearts. Help us to understand for those who don't and for those who may understand just a little bit. Lord, increase our understanding in each heart. And may we give you just a little bit back what you have given to us through this offering, and may it be used for your kingdom's sake. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Lord, lift up his countenance upon you. The Lord be gracious to you and give you peace. And may his kingdom continue to grow.